Welcome to the Thursday, May 12th, 2016 meeting of...
Wait, it's Tuesday.
I'm sorry, it's Tuesday. Ready, looking at the wrong one, okay? Tuesday, May 10th, 2016, meeting of the Grand Blanc Charter Township. Welcome, we're glad to have you here with us. And we'd like to start out the meeting with a pledge to allegiance. Mr. Anderson, do you this?
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And moving forward, I would ask for an approval of the agenda.
Madam Chair, I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as presented. I just wanted, there's somebody asking me a question about the agendas, if they see two of them. And just might explain to them that we go through both agendas this evening, right? And talk through them, so.
Yes.
And I'll make the motion.
I would support that with the comment that we are approving tonight's agenda.
Tuesday one.
But it says in the agenda we're going to review or go over the items on the Thursday night agenda. Mr. Laddie, is that a fair statement?
That is a fair statement.
Okay. This is when we discuss these things.
Yes.
So that we have a chance to get all points before we go into our final meeting, the final meeting on Thursday night. Okay, I'm sorry, did I have a second on that?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep. Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? The agenda is approved. Do we have somebody here from the historical district tonight?
No, you're on the wrong page.
Oh, this is the wrong, I've got two agendas here, but not Tuesdays.
Okay.
Here we are, thank you. And so now it's time for public comment. Is there anybody here who wishes to make public comment? Would you come up to the podium give your name and address, please?
Hi, my name is Ruth Straw, 6580 King Point Road here in Grand Blanc. And the comment I have tonight is my husband came up on Monday to talk to the deputy clerk, who apparently is no longer working for him. I'm greatly concerned about the election this fall. When you let somebody go that close, we're going to end up with chaos, is my fear. Whoever you can get in here is not going to have any election under their belt. There'll be a primary in August. We have been working since the last presidential election on the new computer. We're still not great at them. We're getting better. And Sue is the one on my speed dial. How do I do this? We've got a problem here. She is the one and only one that we end up talking to. So I'm greatly concerned when we do not have her, how this is going to work.
Ruth, how do you spell your last name?
Straw, S-T-R-A-W.
Yes, come forward, please.
Yeah, my name is John Straw, same address. I have the same concerns as my wife. I worked precinct 4, she worked precinct 9. We've been working for, 10 years, the elections. And I've been chair and co-chair, as has Ruth, from time to time. I came Monday to talk to Sue with some questions and suggestions about how we could make the process for the general election in November maybe run a little smoother. And learn that she was no longer working here. My question is, can you tell me why she was let go?
Oh. clerk's jurisdiction.
Okay. My follow-up question would, then would be, whatever reason she was let go, was there a process that was followed? Was she told, you're not doing this correctly, or you're not doing this at all, or you've done this and it's a violation of whatever, and given a chance to correct or change that behavior or whatever? In other words, is there not a due process where an employee...
It is entirely under the clerk's jurisdiction.
Okay.
The rest of us have no part in that.
My hunch is that it was a political decision because Sue has announced her candidacy for the clerk's position. And I guess I would question, is that legal? If that's the reason she was let go.
Well, Madam Chair, can I offer a quick response? According to Michigan statute, the deputy clerk and the deputy treasurer serve at the pleasure of the clerk and the treasurer. And the contracts that we prepare for our deputy clerks in the township identify them as at-will employees, and they serve completely at the pleasure of the clerk or the treasurer. And so the board doesn't have any ability to influence or change that decision. They are involved in the compensation, though, for those positions. But as far as the legality of it are concerned, we reviewed the legality of the decision for any reason or no reason based on the statutory language and the case law, not only just in the state of Michigan, but also the United States. And political appointees, again, that serve at the pleasure of an elected official, again, serve at that person's discretion, and that's it. And as Madam Supervisor pointed out, the clerk has the authority to make that decision, and she's got the ability to make it, and she did.
Okay. Yeah, we're not friends of Sue. We don't socialize with her, but just impressed with her ability as it concerns the election, since we're election workers and we're really worried about how they're going to go without her.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm Florence Owens. I always work the absentee ballots. Sue has more knowledge about this election. Anytime she has handled it, she takes everything downtown. Grand Lake Township, the city of Grand Lake, is always commended on the great job that we've done. I would hate to think that we're going to be the laughing stock of the county without Sue here, because that's what it's going to be. Because you don't even know how to turn on the machines.
I have a deputy clerk who has 8 years experience being a clerk.
But not with us.
Not with us. No, and not running those machines and all the problems. Just little idiosyncrasy things.
I have full confidence in him.
Well, you may have to get a whole lot of new election workers. That's all I got to say, because a wrong person was fired.
Okay. That's okay.
Yes, ma'am. In the back.
My name is Elaine Green. I live at 1308 Norfolk, and I'm very concerned. This year we have to be recertified for our election. I am concerned because anytime we've had problems, Sue's always answered our problems. I've never seen Chris around. I've come in and she's not here. I've come in 4 or 5 times, she's not here. I've come in the afternoon, maybe she might show up. But I think it's very hard for us that work the election to understand why Sue is gone. Because we have an election in August and we have another election in November. And before, I don't know if it's before August or before November, we have to be recertified again. And that's a very hard thing to do. So I hope we get this under control.
Is there anyone else that wishes to make public comment? Ed?
Good evening, Ed Erickson, 2124 Road. I want to try and do a lot of listening and see if you're going. But I do want to ask a couple of comments, and this is regards to item number 10. And the clerk has a right to do whatever she feels in her department. But in your memo, you make a statement here of decided to take the clerk's department in a different direction. We've been going in a direction for 3.5 years now, and we only got maybe 6 months left in this administration. I'd like to know maybe what that direction might be, or you can let the people know that, what that new direction is that doesn't keep this deputy clerk on. And you also make the statement, I feel this is best for the township. I think it'd be nice to know how you feel this is best for the township. And I do have another question. Are you certified? Is our clerk certified to run an election?
Yes.
Thank you. So really, you can do it on your own if you had to.
Yes.
Okay. And my last comment is the gentleman that you apparently have already hired, so it's a done deal.
He has not hired yet.
Oh, okay. It kind of says it near your new deputy clerk, so yeah, I thought you'd have a new deputy clerk. So he isn't hired yet.
Well,
okay, I'm not, by what's in here, I'm not impressed with this when you say he worked for Genesee Township with 29,000 people at 18 precincts. And we have 15 precincts. Well, if you do the math per population, there's 1,167 people going per precinct in Genesee County. In our township, we handle 2,533 first precincts. So that's not very impressive to me. I'm sure it's great government. By that statement, I'm not impressed. Thank you.
I had one comment on that. That has changed since that clerk was there. It is now 9 precincts.
9 precincts where?
In Genesee.
Since he's left?
Since
2008?
Right. It was 2008 when he was there, so evidently there's only 9 now.
9 now, but when he was there, he had twice as many precincts and he had a pretty easy job. Thank you.
I can't do that, I'm sorry. you can call me afterwards.
I'm sorry. No. Beverly Walls. 6353 Perry Road, Grand Lake. I just want to tell you that most of the people that I've worked with on the elections are very loyal to Sue, and I think you're going to have a very difficult time finding that many people to serve. And I'm afraid that the elections are going to be an absolute total mess. Thank you.
Yes, sir? Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry.
Carl Christensen, 7474 Porter Road. I've been a resident over 20 years. When I retired from the Department of Agriculture as a field veterinarian, I began working the elections. Sue has always been the one to answer questions. There may have been others historically, but not currently. If she couldn't fix it, then that was Greg. The only thing you can make the situation worse by would be to let Greg go. You're going to have chaos. I don't like working with chaos. I've had to do it before, and if this is voluntary chaos, I'm out of here. I would question, too, how much this new deputy, proposed deputy, has experience with the computer system. 8 years ago, we weren't computerized like we are now, and if we need recertification, having been working with this for several years, he's way behind already. He's going to have a horrible learning curve with a presidential election coming up, it's going to be a mess. And you're going to need competent people to support him. You may not have them.
Is there anyone else that wishes to come forward?
Hey, Richard Jabagi, G5507, South Saginaw. And the thought that I would consider at this particular point is, since we are coming toward the end of a term for our current township clerk, are we confident that the replacement for Sue would also be a very competent and comfortable replacement for any possible new clerk? Or hopefully if Ms. Reardon should continue, I'm sure that wouldn't be a problem. But this is also a consideration that I think we also need to consider at this point. And certainly hope everything works out for the best for the township. Thank you.
Any new clerk chooses their own deputy.
But again, we would be possibly in a position where we wouldn't have a continuity going from one administration to another, or in previous situations we did. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Again, I'm asking, is there anybody else that wishes to come forward? Seeing none once, twice. Is there anyone else that wishes to come forward? For public, in regard to public comment. Last time, is there anyone else that wishes to come forward for public comment? In that case, public comment is closed. And now I'll ask for approval of the minutes. You may do them singly or... Yeah, I'm back in this. Okay, I'm sorry. We will now review the Township Board agenda for Thursday. And so we will go down consider a request from the GIS Director to approve the purchase of a Dell R530E server configuration recommended by Video Insight, along with Video Insight camera software from Teoma Systems for $14,486.50 plus shipping. This is to upgrade our existing system.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I just spoke with Robbie right before the meeting started. He just received some new information in regards to this, and he would like to have more time to research it because it looks like the cost with licensing and the cameras, the difference between the systems he was looking at, the one we pay one fee and then the cameras are licensed, you're licensed for 71 cameras or whatever it is, and if we need to switch cameras out, that licensing fee stays with it, the maintenance fee covers it. With this new system, he just found out late this afternoon that it costs $175 to register each camera, and if we had to replace that camera, you'd pay another $175 registration fee. He's not as comfortable with his recommendation, so he's asked if the board would consider moving this to the agenda of May 24th to allow him to provide better information to make a decision upon.
All right.
I'll make a motion to remove this item from the Thursday night's agenda and place it on the May 24th agenda if deemed ready at that time for a decision by Robbie Beller. Second.
Thank you. Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? It is scheduled for the May 24th agenda.
Thank you.
The board shall consider approving the Greek Festival outdoor gathering permit for June 16th through the 19th, 2016, pending the approval of the traffic control request from the County Road Commission. This has been a part of our agenda for many years now.
Did we get that? Yeah.
The only issue that I would have with that is in their application, they put Chief Stan. It should be Chief Wiles.
Oh, okay, yes.
So they probably copied last year's application. Yeah, some change today.
Okay.
But as you know, as part of the outdoor gathering permit, we also post no parking signs along Baldwin Road and Cobbler's Way. Yeah. To do that, we need permission from the Road Commission to do that. I spoke with Bonnie Wood to find out the correct process to do that, and all she needed was a letter submitted to her, signed by Ms. Hoffman, which is done, forward to the Road Commission, and they will review that at the next board meeting, and I'm anticipating approval of that. As soon as it's approved, I will certainly let the board know, and we should be all set with that aspect of it.
Okay. Thank you.
It's a great event. I have no questions or problems with it. The police department, the commission, right, always do an outstanding job. Yeah. The Greek Orthodox Church runs a top-notch festival. It's great for the community.
Okay. Any other discussion?
I live next door to it.
It's entertainment, right?
My neighbors and I enjoy the music.
I was going to say.
If it's nice weather.
Right. All those in favor?
Well, no, it's on Thursday.
It's just Thursday.
Oh, that's right.
Right.
And now we have the deputy clerk. We will be working on the compensation. And I turn this over to the lawyer now.
Well, that's correct, Madam Chair, and we talked a little bit about it tonight. According to the statute, the clerk has the discretion to select a deputy clerk at any point in time during their election tenure. And we know that Clerk Reardon has exercised her discretion in that regard. And we have, she has a potential person that she would like to name as her new deputy clerk, but we have to discuss the compensation for the job. And so what I'd like to do is I've written you a confidential attorney correspondence. I'd like to discuss that in an executive session. We'll only be talking about the elements of compensation. We're not going to talk about the merits of a candidate or a past employee. So I'd like you to allow some time tonight for an executive session to discuss that potential compensation. And if there's any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them at this point.
Okay. Thank you. So we'll move on then. The board shall consider setting a public hearing date for the state revolving fund project plan for June 28th, 2016 board meeting. Mr. Potter?
Good evening. As you know, we've been working on the state revolving fund project plan for the last month or so. And as part of that process, we need to set a public hearing date and some other dates. We'll have to advertise the draft plan for review on May 19th, and I sent Clerk Reardon an email today, and we'll send her the advertisement to go into the Grand Blanc View for that. So we have a 30-day review period for that, and then that would be June 18th, and then we would have a public hearing scheduled for June 28th, at which time we would have a public hearing and the board would pass a resolution approving the project plan.
Do you want to go just a little bit into what's covered under that state revolving fund project?
What's covered on that state revolving project, as we discussed, was a number of projects that may be able to be funded with low interest loans through the state at 2.5%. We have to go through a rather lengthy process in order to get those projects in front of the DWRI program for review. So developing the project plan goes through a lot of steps, and we're putting together a lot of information that'll have to be reviewed by DWRF, the state, and the EQ, and then public noticed, and then we'll go through the public hearing. We had a conference call with the DEQ this morning that went reasonably well. They threw two new programs at us that we have to jump through in order to get through this process. So between now and Thursday's meeting, we'll need to meet with Dennis and with Jeff to review those new steps and see if that's going to change our process at all. It's going to, it would incur some additional costs for the township that we didn't anticipate in preparing this. So we'd have to go through it with Dennis and Jeff and come back with recommendations to the board on Thursday night. So these could change depending on how that conversation goes.
Yes.
Is it, during the process a month ago when we approved the freedom to move forward, the DPW director as well, you folks, we asked, well, at least I did anyway, for some type of an outline as to the specific projects, and I know that that can change a little bit, but we've got a long-range plan, we've got a short-term plan. In try to assign a priority to, we gotta have this. This could wait, kind of thing, and what the total thought process is on the dollar amount that we're seeking to borrow. Okay.
Correct.
And then how much? With that, the board can decide financially. Do we want to pay as we go on some of it? Do we want to finance? But I'd like a conceptual plan by Thursday before I vote on it if we can.
And we're providing that. The issue is that they've got a new requirement. I don't know if you remember that we applied for a SAW grant a year and a half, 2 years ago, to prepare an asset management plan.
Yeah.
And we applied for about a $1.1 million SAW grant to do an asset management plan for the sanitary sewer system. Well, what we just found out is that the state has just made an asset management plan part of the requirement for getting a loan. So we have to decide whether the cost that would be incurred in order to prepare an asset management plan as part of this process is worth spending money right now. So, and there's another curve in that you can also apply for an SRF loan to prepare the asset management plan.
It's that expensive?
It's $1 million, I mean.
What, the plan?
Yeah, the grant that we requested was for $1 million to prepare an asset management plan.
Right, but the actual cost to...
That's the things that we have to talk about with Dennis and Jeff is to outline, because there's a number of options, and I'd want to get into the entire thing in front of the board tonight until we have a chance to discuss it. But there is a number of costs that could be incurred, and there's a number of ways to pay for those costs. But to your question, we have prepared the project priority list, we've assigned costs to those, we've actually done the amortization schedules and what the cost per user would be for each of those projects. And we'll have that information. And I'm not sure that we'll have it for Thursday, but for Thursday, all you're doing is setting a public hearing date. You're not approving anything.
Okay.
So in the meantime, we'll have prepared the project plan by the 19th of May. You'll have 30 days along with everybody else to review the plan, and we can go through it with all the board members that we would like. So all of those things, we will go through all those steps. But for Thursday night, the only real decision we have is to set a public hearing date. That's.
And you'll have preliminary costs to Mr. Limited by Thursday for the amount you talked about tonight that you found out it's going to be more?
We're going to review those costs and how and whether and how we want to approach that.
Okay.
I have a question.
Thank you. Yes.
So item number 12, are we not doing that tomorrow night?
Thursday night?
Thursday night.
No. Item number 12 is actually you passed the resolution on the June 28th meeting.
Right, okay.
Okay.
Wanted the board to be aware that was part of the June 28th meeting.
Okay.
Thank you.
So 11 and 12 will be together.
Yes.
So the asset management plan, that's about $1.1 million.
That's to do the entire township. Now, there's other options that are available under this program, and that's what we need to discuss. But okay. To do the entire sanitary sewer system in the township would be about $1.1 million was what we did in the application. Now, when you're doing the application, obviously it's a grant, so you make sure that you've got costs covered. So it could come in underneath that cost, but that's the cost that we estimated when we put the application.
And so absent that grant, we could apply for a partner grant with the real grant.
We can, well, there were so many applicants for the SAW grant that they had to have a lottery because there was $600 million in requests for $400 million of funds. So they did a lottery for all of the communities of Michigan, and we ended up being like 10th from the end. So we have, at this point, unless there's a new set of funding that comes out after, the last set of funding comes out in September 2017. If they refund the program, then we would have a chance in 2017 or 18. So that's part of the discussion that we need to have too, is this something that we want to go forward with now, or want to wait to see what happens in 17, be part of it. There's a lot of options that are available to us. We just need to go through them and bring to the board what we think our best recommendation is.
Just wanted to clarify one item. I know on your report where you listed a lot of those different projects, actually you listed, you know, quite a few of them, District 6 and 11 and 7, but the total amount of all of them was like $22 million, right?
That's the entire six-year CIP.
Right, but it's $22 million out there potentially that we would have to work on. And I know there was only about $16 million that you were looking on just those first three or four projects, but when you talk about the $1 million project, that's separate from this $22
million? That project is an asset management plan. In essence, what has to happen is you have to look at all of the assets in your sanitary sewer system, look at the condition of those, give them a condition rating, a cost to maintain those, and replace them in whatever lifetime they have assigned to them. So it's a rather complex process.
So it is on top of that then, right?
But the $1 million is outside of this, this scope.
Because that's like the maintenance of the existing system, right?
Yeah, this is a new curve.
Right.
Scott. Thank you.
So basically they want a plan of everything else is being maintained before they approve funding for some new projects.
And in essence, what they've done throughout the state is put some kind of hook into everybody. If you have an NPDES permit to discharge to the waters of the state, you're required to have an asset management plan prior to getting your next NPDES permit approved. If you got a SAW grant, you have to put an asset management plan into place, and you have to fund that asset management place. So every place that they have a chance to require it, they're doing that now.
Is this something new that they're requiring? Or?
It's relatively new. I mean, asset management has been around for 8 or 10 years in the conversation, but the feds and the state have really only started requiring it in the last 4 years. And we're going to see it happen in the water side of the business too. I mean, the sewer side's first because it has the ability to impact, usually has the ability to impact things more than the water system does.
Well, it seems expensive. What I would say is that putting that asset management plan in place, before they're going to loan you money or let you use those revolving funds, the idea behind it being they just need to know that we as a municipality have a plan and we intend to work it. They don't want to give money if you're letting one side of your system erode while you're borrowing money to build on and then you don't have the ability to pay it back. So really what we're going to do is put a plan together that's long-term, that shows that not only do we have a plan that's going to allow us to manage it for today and tomorrow, but that we'll also be able to take care of the new additions to our infrastructure as well.
And the actual plan is now called the Fiscal Sustainability Plan.
So it's like going to the bank and not having a business plan.
Exactly.
Okay. Everybody's questions answered temporarily anyway. Thank you. Okay, the next is on the agenda is the motion to approve the purchase and installation of two emergency standby generators at the Baldwin I-75 and Grandview Lakes two pump stations for $65,000 and authorize the township superintendent to execute all related contracts and documents. Mr. Sears.
Good evening, everybody. So at the April 12th board meeting, you might remember I brought these generators forth and I brought you one price from Cummins Bridgeway. The board asked administration to go back and get additional prices, which we obliged. I gave Dave Hobson the task. He was able to quickly received two additional quotes, which I did include for you in your packets tonight in the memo from Gen Power and Kennedy Industries. Both companies came in more expensive than Gen Power, or Cummins Bridgeway, I apologize. Gen Power's smaller generator was cheaper, but it's a Kohler. So staying with, you know, the fact that we want to stick with Cummins generators, we are continuing the same recommendation we had at the last meeting to purchase the generators from Cummins Bridgeway.
Okay. Questions, anyone?
Thank you, Lily.
Sure. Yes?
I just have one question. Thanks for getting that detail. It was very helpful. And I know that it came up to about $59,000, but I know you added an extra $5,600, you know, which is like 10%.
I did. Some of these estimates that Dave gave us, my assistant director, are very ballpark estimates. And that includes the electrical and the pipe fitting, mechanical, and the concrete. We do not have firm estimates on those. The electrical is really close, but until we get the generators, we're comfortable with these prices that he's laid out here. But we always want to have that little bit of buffer.
So we didn't actually get an electrical quote then?
The quote that you have there is what the price we've been receiving on every generator we've done with that electrician. And he's verbally told us that he would, you know, stick with that price. You never know what you're going to come upon though when you have these types of projects. It's like any other infrastructure project, something could change, it could be some unforeseen problem. So, you know, building in a buffer there just protects us so that, you know, we have a little bit extra. I don't anticipate to be any more than what Dave right here.
So that's maxed out.
I believe so, yeah. And this does include you know, services that will be done by the DPW also, but I wanted the board to approve every expense this time, not just the purchase of the generators and the gas service and stuff.
Yeah, because it's helpful for me, so when we go through the pay, we've got to have the money there.
Right.
So I'm glad you bundled it all together.
Absolutely.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, and we will get written quotes for each generator site before we proceed.
Right, and same with the pads and everything else, right?
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, thank you so much.
No problem.
Any other questions? All right, moving on then, the board shall consider a request from Police Chief Ron Wiles to approve the purchase of one 2016 Chevrolet Tahoe Police Pursuit rated 4WD marked that vehicle to be used in the patrol division for a cost of $38,769 and dollars. This request includes an additional $7,500 for ancillary equipment to outfit the marked vehicle. The total cost, $46,269, has been budgeted for in capital projects for police vehicles and can be used to purchase the vehicles and equipment. Do you have any questions for Ron in regard to this purchase? Yes?
This wasn't part of the leasing study that we're doing.
It was part of our conversation. You know, we had talked about that Chief Wiles and I had set aside $122,000 this year for the purchase of vehicles. And when we presented the lease option to the board previously, this was the one that was, because it's a cruiser, it's not eligible for the lease through Enterprise Fleet. Yeah. So this is one we knew we did have to move forward with.
Detective cars only, if I recall.
Right, that's correct.
You're moving one out now?
Correct. The 2008 Ford Convictoria is the oldest car in the fleet. Last of the 2008s.
Wow. I only have one, it's not a question, but the concern is, presently we have one four-wheel drive cruiser. That's the DOT accident investigation vehicle, is that correct? Or
actually, we have two.
We have two.
And then
now
one of our pool cars, which is one of our old cruisers, is four-wheel drive also. We have two marked four-wheel drive ones.
In.
And that's part of the reason for the request for a third, because we found these last few winters, we get these, you know, extreme amounts of snow and we struggle on certain shifts, you know, getting cars out there and being able to respond to calls effectively. Okay.
Yeah, I don't have an objection to it. I was just curious if that was a trend we're moving towards and if that was considered. So, thank you.
Anyone else have any questions, comments? Okay. Thank you. And the last, the grant request policy to review, turn it over to Superintendent Lee.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I put this on, and I'm sure you guys know I wasn't here at the last meeting, but we had a lot of board conversation in regards to the last two grants that had come from the fire department. And I noticed when I rewatched the meeting on the YouTube that there was much conversation about the actual policy itself or the procedure that we go through, and there was some consternation among some board members about not seeing the grants before they went through. So I had thought that this might be a good topic of review for the board to provide some direction. If we wanted to formalize that policy or procedure, we'd be happy to do so, but we would need some direction as an administrative team. And I thought the conversation might go around if, and this isn't to just apply to the fire department, this would apply to any department of the township, including just the general township and looking for grant opportunities, that there is a review process before submittal. And what would the board like to see is that, you know, we're in joint, like the fire or parks and rec, where we're joint with the city. Do you want to review by elected officials so that it gets reviewed by the township board and the city commission, or that it just goes through administrative staff, which may be me and city manager Wendy Jean Buer? I just want some, you know, some direction from the board on, you know, are we okay with the way it is? I mean, the fire commission certainly has the ability and authority in their bylaws to approve these and move them forward, as is parks and rec. But after listening to the last meeting, I just wanted to make sure that either we're okay with that procedure, you may want some to tighten up that procedure and have a review before submittal. I'm throwing it out there for board's conversation.
Yes. Go ahead.
Yes, I think we should tighten it up, and I think you and the city manager should review all that and come upon it and then just copy us on it so we know what's occurring, but at least you'd have the final say to say everything's okay, we've checked it, and we think a grant to go forward with. So I think you and the mayor should definitely be looking that over and then just reporting your findings to us.
Jude?
Well, I know when I was writing grants for the police department that we couldn't submit anything without going through, well, at first, Supervisor Zittle, and then second, you, when you took over. So, I mean, I would think that we would still want that, because I think we are putting ourselves out there as the agency that is responsible. Because, you know, I was looking over this one fire grant, and there were issues, I think, that said our fire department isn't trained on how to use axes and nozzles, and we're swearing to this, I think. I mean, come on up.
That's where we turned it down.
I think you were given a lot of misinformation or information that was not understood. And during the time with that grant, there were three firefighters going through the fire academy. So in truth, and to be accurate, I could not, or the grant writer could not turn around and say we were all trained in those items, because there were three members going through the fire academy who were not trained in that.
So the question, this is for the SCBAs, is your department trained in the proper use of equipment being requested? It's saying, is your department? And so whenever you're bringing on somebody new, you're always going to say no, because you're going to say that they're the department?
Not if they're going through the fire academy. To be accurate, yes, that's what I would put down. And at this point in time, I've actually sent emails to the FEMA for the AFG grant and also for the SAFER grant, and have withdrawn both.
Yeah, see, this isn't, there's nowhere in here that it's talking about, I guess, specific individual department members. It's talking about the department.
Right, the department.
The department would be the collective, correct?
Of all the members, yes.
Right. So is the department trained, and you're saying your department?
At this point, yes, because they went through the fire academy. There's only one member at this point who hasn't passed his final exam. So at this point, yes, but during the grant period, okay, they were going through the fire academy, so to be accurate.
Yeah, is the application for the grant doesn't say are all your firefighters, it just refers to the department as a whole. Right. I can understand the logic of that is there are how many part-time firefighters?
37.
32 to 34 is what I'm thinking of?
37, right.
37, okay. And three of the 7 had not completed the fire academy at that time.
Yeah, so it, when they're talking about the department, I'm not gonna get into arguing about that, it's not worth it.
We are looking at all of the departments. As I say, we've turned in historical grants, and I'd like to have people review it. We have, and now the Parks and Recreation turns in theirs now. And so I just think it's a good idea to have that final check off.
Yeah. I would agree.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I concur with, you know, comments made in terms of there needs to be some kind of administrative review, if nothing else. You know, if I was writing a grant for a department, I'd want another pair of eyes on it just to say, hey, here's something else you can throw in here, or I'm not comfortable saying that or whatever. But, you know, if there are departments that are solely Grand Blanc Township departments, then it's probably just our administration that needs to look at it. If it's, you know, something that's the library or something that's the Parks and Rec or fire, then we need to get with the city on it and have them review it with us. But and it might even be interesting to have a meeting with whoever's writing the grant so that, you know, things like, hey, this is asking, is the department trained on this issue? What do they mean by that? And ask the grant writer their opinion. Well, because I'm not a grant writer, but, you know.
Sometimes they have an idea that can make or break the grant, you know, right. And add to it. So anything we can do to make sure we get the money is good.
Right.
Yes.
If this is the way we want to go, I'm fine with having management review that, and by management I mean the township superintendent. If it's a joint city township venture such as parks or so forth, then the city administrator as well should review it. We need to make sure, I don't want to get into having this board review every grant application, because what will happen is every grant application deadline will come and pass and expire before we agree on paragraph one. So totally agree with that, as long as it's a policy across the board with all grants and all departments.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes,
Chair. I'm in agreement with that. But at a minimum, the township superintendent, you know, a couple of key points in the SAFER grant was the. I'm sure Mr. Lehman would have caught that about the effect possibly on labor negotiations, and that would afford him the opportunity to bounce that off our council. Which Mr. Maddy made his opinion based on, you know, in the discussion here. So I'm agree with you, Mr. Anderson. I don't want the board to have to go through every grant application, because you're exactly right. But at a minimum, the township superintendent, and then whatever he sees or she sees as flags, would run it by the township council and then give it the blessing. And like Larry said, if it's a joint venture with the city, then of course the city manager ought to be involved in that as well. So I'm in agreement with that. Tweaking, if you will, of the policy.
Yes.
I agree with that part too. I think that you should do it, Dennis should do it, and David should look at it if necessary. When did you withdraw those grants?
Today. And I also have one grant that's in right now, and once I get back to the station, either tonight or tomorrow, that will go to Superintendent Murta and also the city manager, and that's for fire prevention. Make sure they're on board, or if they want me to withdraw that as well.
Okay. Thank you, Dave.
Mm-hmm. Well, this seems like a relatively simple agreement. Mm-hmm. Could we have this drawn up in a form that we can adopt on Thursday night's meeting?
Absolutely. That's what I was hoping our conversation tonight, because I think what we need to do is just formalize the policy and the procedure. It can be real quick and easy that they have a review. I think a timeline in there would be good. Our goal would be to review them 30 days prior to the submission. I know that's tight because of the way really things come together.
If I could get at least a minimum of a week, I would greatly appreciate it. Right around
all the grant time. I've got several grants going out all at one time. If I get more help, I definitely can accommodate that. Right now, it's just going to be me writing out. I'm looking into classes and seeing who would be available or willing to write grants for us within the department.
Then I would agree to a 14-day review period prior to submission.
Yeah.
I was going to say 10, so 14 is reasonable, sure.
Because I think that you've got to have time to take an action if you see something, and it might mean we have to go out and grab more data, put it together. Because the alternative is, if it's a week before and we find something that we think negates the opportunity to submit the grant, it means we wait an entire year cycle before we would go again.
These grants, too, just so you're aware, they're 30 days. You're notified pretty much Johnny on the spot, and you have 30 days from that point. So it's not a long term.
I agree, but there's also, we know which grants we're going to go after on a cyclical basis for the following year.
Now,
that means right now for AFG and SAFER grant for next year, if you want to pursue them, we can put the information together now. We can gather information so that you are really ready to go and you have all of your files together, that when the grant process opens and you have 30 days, it means you have to jam. I understand it. And if you're using a grant writer or whatever, provide them the information, tell them to get going, and know that we want it back with a 14-day turnaround time before submittal.
Correct. And this year's work basically will lead up to next year, which will help out for next year. So that's definitely doable.
Okay. I just want to make sure it applies. When I write this, it will apply to all departments of the township or the overall township.
Right.
I'm not picking on the fire department, Dave. You know, it's police department, fire department, anything that we do, parks and rec, whoever, sure. Historical, whoever we're doing, we want to review everything moving forward.
And anything that I put in for is for the good of the department and also the citizens, the communities that we serve. We're just trying to make sure the community gets the very best service. That's extremely important to me.
Sorry?
Are you sure 14 days is enough time? Because what if you're on vacation for a week? And what if it comes in, do you have enough time to really review it? Because I don't think we should lock into that unless you...
It is tight. When the window opens, you really do. You have this much time for data entry, basically, and then you do a review, a cursory review. You have to see what needs to be changed. And then you gather the information, change it, and move it in. I think a week, if you do it with a 7-day, I think you're asking for trouble because we just may not be able to gather the information. Like I said, that means we sit out for a year. Like we're doing this time, apparently, sitting out for a year. I would much rather have the 2 weeks to correct and provide it. And it also would give us in a 14-day time frame, if there were a question on something, it could go to elected officials if it needed to have, whether it might be a letter for a SAFER grant that would require that we submit a letter that would guarantee that, you know, there's no cuts for 2 years, something like that. We would want that 14 days to be able to call a special meeting to convene a majority and be able to move on something like that.
Scott?
Yeah, I think the idea is just to develop communication on these grants so that, you know, if you see a grant or any department that sees a grant that they comes out, you say 30 days before, you know, we have to apply, is to maybe shoot an email over to Dennis or whoever, city manager and Dennis and our
set manager, up the time frame.
And just say, hey, you know what, I'm looking at this grant and we're thinking of applying for it. Now, you know, they scan through the rules, you know, the guidelines for the grant, and there's something that sticks out like a sore thumb.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going all the way down the path of pulling data when they say, hey, wait a minute, there's something here that I'm not sure we even want to. Or, hey, you know what, this is something really good. We need to devote some other people to this. So I would say you might not have to wait until you start writing the grant. It may be just when you have an indication of, and that would go for any department, mm-hmm. that they see a grant, hey, I'm going to submit it to the city and the township so that we can get on this thing and know whether or not this is something I want to go down the path on.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully it just develops, you know, communication on these grants so that we don't end up going down, you know, you doing a bunch of work that, you know.
I don't mind doing the work. It was to do the right thing, basically, and basically for the community.
Yeah.
And it's a learning curve as well, so I learned a lot.
Sure.
And I'm taking, you know, a plus from it. So this is going to get me ready for next year, and of course, next year I'll be going, whoever's in the board, I'll be asking for a letter for the SAFER grant.
Yep, so. And we appreciate any department that goes after grant money. I mean, if we can supplement our parks, we can supplement any department with grant money.
Right.
So far this year, I mean, I've almost gotten, almost just through the community partnerships and their grants and everything, almost $30,000. So I'm just trying to make sure we have the best service, as I said, for the community.
Yep, well, thanks for your work on that.
All right, thanks.
Okay. Jeff, it's your turn. Tell us about census.
Good evening again. First of all, I'm pleased to report that our department is done with the installation of MX2s. That pesky bill I keep bringing to you year after year, $100,000 to install those little white boxes in your homes. We're almost 100% done. There are two accounts that remain out there that we have not installed. One of them is General Motors, and that's something we're working out with the city, and another one's a resident in Holly Township, which we're working out also. So we're very happy that that's finished. We're able to read our meters 100%. By Township Hall now, so we don't have to send out a meter reader anymore. It's helped out tremendously. I've provided you considerable information tonight on the next step in the process, which is looking at the technology we have now. How do we maintain it, and how does it need to be upgraded from 6 years ago when we first started this whole thing? Right now, we have physical servers here at Township Hall that are somewhat maintained and updated. You've heard in the past, we kind of have an overburdened GIS department that we all kind of dump stuff on every day, all day long. And in the DPW, we've really been trying to get away from having physical computer equipment like servers and information stored here in Township Hall. I brought several things to you guys in the past. SCADA is hosted now over the CityWorks is going to be hosted. Our two big systems, the next one that we're looking at is FlexNet. We do not want to rely on physical servers here anymore. We would like to look into the possibility of hosting that information with census rather than us doing it. Our partners in this Indoba Mundy Township really brought this to light. They've expressed great concern over their servers over there. They've had a lot of problems with them in the past few months even, and they're strongly looking at going to the system. However, because we're partners with them, they can't do anything if we don't do anything. And it's the same vice versa. So tonight I brought to you some information regarding census analytics, which is the next big thing for Census Metering Company. It's a system where they'll host all of our information, they'll host our servers. Basically, we will still continue to read the meters, and then that information will get pushed out to the web. And they take care of everything. They secure it. It's 100% encrypted. There's no security problems that we're aware of and that we have no concerns over it. I gave you a presentation from Census Meters. I'm not going to go through that presentation tonight. That was for your review, but it does highlight several key points that I want to make. One is the ability for us to provide information to our customers and the ability for us to analyze information. You wouldn't think water use would be that big of a deal, but really it is with a system our size, with 35,000 residents here in the township and 7,500 water meters. We use a lot of water throughout the year. And one thing we're excited about is we have very good water efficiency in our township. And we want to keep it that way. This gives us the ability to analyze our water meter reads right down to the property. It gives residents the ability to monitor their water usage. I did include, I think there's a snapshot in the PowerPoint of a customer portal that we could even utilize where residents would be able to go out, they would register on the website, and they can go on and view their usage. They can see graphs, they can set up alarms, they can set up reminders, they can even pay their bill if we link it to our system we currently have now. So in our department, we see an extreme need from our residents to budget and to want more from their water bills. They want to be able to do more. They don't want to just write us a check every month. they want to know more. We probably get easily 10, 15 calls a day, people wanting this kind of information. Right now, it's difficult for us to obtain. It's a lengthy process to run reports in the FlexNet system. And really, this will be able to, we'll be able to pull up their account, and everything is right there on the dashboard. The customer portal is the same way. They'll be able to pull it up right there online. They can go on and log on off of our website. All the information is right there. Reports are a big thing. Right now, the only report that we really can utilize in our department is a high consumption report, and we manually run it once a month. Basically, what we do is we say any properties that are using 10,000 cubic feet or more, flag them, and we will go check them, because that generally tells us that somebody has a problem. Right now, it's very difficult because we have to differentiate between customer accounts and residential accounts. We're not able to do that automatically. So we don't run the report as often because it will literally bring up 100 different accounts that we need to go check. With Census Analytics, it does it automatically. We can make groups. We can say if there's continuous usage in a residential property overnight, alarm us immediately. And the next morning we'll come in and check, and we'll send a technician to the home to check it because they have a leak, something's going on. There's nothing worse than somebody coming to my counter with a $3,000 water bill, begging for me to reverse the charges, and I can't do it because they had a leak, and there's nothing I can do. Consumption is consumption. We have to pay for it, so they have to pay for it. These kinds of things, these kinds of technology that we have access to, really is what customer service is all about. It's what we can do for our residents. This technology also opens doors to other things. There's a very exciting, actually, leak detection system that we could integrate into our infrastructure to where we can monitor river crossings, we can monitor old neighborhoods with infrastructure, and FlexNet will tell us if there's a water main break, even the slightest leak that may take months to surface, that can cost us a lot of money. This system will be able to tell us that there's something going on there, you need to go check it. So there's really a lot of exciting things going on that we would like to definitely look into. With all of this, though, you know, obviously there's a cost to it, and you guys always know that I'm getting to the cost of it. The yearly fees will increase quite a bit. Right now, we're paying less than $10,000 a year for our FlexNet system. Actually, I think it's between $500 and $7,500. We're still trying to get that information together. There's several bills that we get for the FlexNet system that we're assembling to get real numbers. And the annual fees will go up to $24,000 a year, which is a hefty price. But whenever you think of all of the services we're going to be able to offer residents, and then the lack of maintenance that we have to perform here in Township Hall. Right now, I don't know the last time our servers have been updated. So it's kind of scary to me that the system could crash and we would not be able to get any meter reads. So
I would imagine if you found one major leak with it, it would pay for itself.
It very well could, absolutely. Just the slightest water main break overnight can cost that much money for the whole entire year. So we're really excited about this program. Mundy Township is even more excited about this program. They're voting on it at the end of the month. And basically, I wanted to bring this to you guys tonight, give you all the information, and just kind of have a question and answer. Take any questions back that I can bring answers back with, so that we're all familiar with the system to make an educated decision rather than just bring it to you for a vote without you knowing anything about it.
Okay. Yes.
Mundy Township has more money, but
well, yeah, I hear that quite a bit. They have less meters than we do, so it's cheaper for them.
Yeah.
But
no, I've got a couple of questions.
Sure.
One thing that I don't know was mentioned. You know, if we have one break, it'd be interesting to know. You know, what that's cost us in the past. You know, what
right.
One break has cost us. Just you know, because I'm thinking that hey, if it's $15,000-$20,000,
sure, absolutely.
The other thing is, I'm wondering, what other, if we found any other municipalities in Michigan that are using it, and have we looked at, you know, gone and met with them and said, hey, you know, how's this thing working out?
We're doing that now, actually. There's about 100 different municipalities throughout the country that are using this. This is fairly new technology. Like I said, this is their latest and greatest. So we have the list of those municipalities. We just met with Census last week on this, and we just got this list at the beginning of this week. So we are checking references. If there's anywhere in the area, I know there are some municipalities in Michigan, we will certainly talk to them and visit them, and we'll call nationwide also to get that information.
The other thing is, you know, we mentioned that the servers, what the cost of those are if they go out.
Correct.
Knowing what the cost of our servers would be to replace them would be a good, you know, thing to know.
And we asked that question during the meeting, and the ballpark was about 12 grand each, and we had two servers here in the township.
And they're how old?
Right now, I believe they're between 6 and 7 years old. They hold 1 year's information, so we can go back in the FlexSense system for 1 year and view that information history. With this, we'll be able to view 3 years worth of information because we have that much more capacity out on their system.
Okay.
Yes.
One thing I hate doing as I sit up here going on 8 years now is having to raise the rates of our water because our usage fees goes up and a room full of residents who are angry or against that, obviously. I would like to know this. It's a great sounding system. Mm-hmm. I want to make sure the benefit and the cost.
Absolutely.
The rate. So can you kind of try to give us a ballpark as to what this is going to do to the usage bills, the average residents?
I don't anticipate an expense, and this would be a 2017 expense, by the way. That we would not incur any expense until next budget year. I don't anticipate this raising any rates. If anything, I anticipate saving us money with all the technology that we can utilize to save water alone. I think we end up saving money. Scott brought up how much money we can save on a water main break, and I will provide that information. We have what we call, we do an efficiency report every month. Most utilities you'll see are between 10% and 20%. There are some really bad ones that are way above that.
Oh, yeah.
And that's water loss, basically. You lose 20% of the water that you're paying for.
We're in the single digits, aren't we?
We're pretty proud that we're under 10%. We're usually between 5% and 8%. And that bothers us that we have 5% and 8% of water loss. It could be anything. It could be, you know, there are some dishonest people out there that may steal water. I hate to believe that, but, or it could be leaks. It could be leaky pipes out there. You know, just the leak detection equipment that we could put on this system, it could save us that much money. It could be over $1 million a year on water loss. We'll never get to 0% water loss. I don't want to give you that idea.
I'm not expecting that. I just want to make sure that the cost is just the system.
Sure.
Sounds great. But then again, 6 years ago when I was on the board and we approved the present system around, that was stinked out at the time, too.
Absolutely.
Couldn't have been top. This was the best of the best.
And that's what
6 years later.
Nowadays,
well, that's outdated.
Yep.
So.
Well, yeah, a couple questions. How much would Monday Township pay if we were going to pay an extra $15,000? Are they paying an extra $15,000?
I don't have that information, but I doubt it because it's based on the amount of meters that you have, the amount of users,
right.
And Monday Township has far less than we have. They have, I think, less than 2,500.
Right, so that's why they went over that. So their fees.
Will be less, yes.
Right. That's why I would like to look at the servers, because even if we get new servers, we're going to pay maybe $24,000, but they're good for 8 years.
Sure.
Instead of paying an extra $15,000 every year.
And we'll bring that information.
You know, I'm sure you'll bring all that back.
Absolutely.
And then the other point was, is when we went into this system 6 years ago, all the stuff that you were saying you were going to give us, they told us the same thing.
Sure.
We said we were going to get all this activities, reports, and all this stuff. I haven't heard one thing different than what I heard 6 years ago. And
right.
If we get the servers, I guess I can understand getting a bigger servers to do it. So I think the system already has it.
Well,
I mean, that's what we were told.
Okay? We can run, like I said, we can run those reports now, but it's not an easy thing to do.
I know, but they
can't
said
do
it was an easy thing to do.
I understand
said it was
that's what
work,
they said.
Okay,
and
now you're telling me it's
hold
not.
Hold on, can I clear one thing up for you? He wasn't DPW director then.
I know
so
he
don't wasn't. Say what he said, because he didn't say
not,
it.
I'm just telling you what I was told.
Right. Yeah, I
say
it.
I agree with that.
And that point was brought up. Definitely it was brought up by our own staff. This was supposed to be an easy thing.
This was a lot of money. This was a big investment, and we did it to save money. And I haven't heard one thing different than what I heard 6 years ago.
I agree.
So I think if you can get us the numbers on the servers.
I will.
And then compare it, because if we have the proper servers, we can do all the stuff you want to do, right?
We can, but it's much more difficult. We can't give the residents as much information as they want right now. We can't break it down nearly as well as we will be with this software.
Well, then they told us something wrong, because they said the residents were going to know everything, and they could call us direct.
Right now, we can't give the customers the customer portal. We can't give them the alarm set. You know, Larry could get a text message or an email in the middle of the night if suddenly he has a problem, and he doesn't know it because he's sleeping. That can save him a lot of money. The customer service is a big point that I want to stress here. What we'll be able to do for our residents, I think it's huge.
Right.
And I'll outline that more when I come back to the board with that. And I would like, hopefully I'll have somebody from Census here with me.
This was just supposed to be an introduction.
Absolutely. I want to discuss it too, because I want to get all of our concerns out there. Right.
I appreciate you bringing it back. But a lot of it did sound the same. And then with the comparison, we can see which is more cost effective.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, you know, $15,000 a year.
I agree.
And it's going to go up every year.
So you're going to, this will give real-time data to
customers.
And that's the difference between this, our current system, that it's historical versus this.
It was supposed to be real-time.
We currently get reads every hour on the hour.
Yeah.
And we can see that now.
So could our residents get alerts then?
No, not now. Not with the system we have.
Right.
Right now, once a month, like I said, once a month we go through and we run that consumption report. And as difficult as a process as it is, that's as often as we can do it right now. I'd like to say we can go and do it once a day, but it would take an employee a whole day to do it once a day.
That's great.
Yes,
that's kind of discouraging, because that's not what we were told. And we weren't there, okay? But what we were told was we were going to have this stuff, and it was going to be easy and save all this time for our employees, and everybody would have it. Now it doesn't seem like it had.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wasn't here for those meetings, but I know that car salesmen are probably selling cars mentioning the same features that knew that they had 10 years ago. But I think a ROI, that you're going to put together would be helpful, but I'm wondering too if there's any competitors that can do the same thing that could be looked at.
There are third party people that we could look at to give us a customer portal, but as far as our FlexNet system, this is the software that it's kind of like a Windows computer with Windows. You can't put Windows on an Apple computer. It's the same concept. There are third party people that can give us a customer portal. And that was discussed in the meeting also, that we could look at that also, which we will always evaluate every option we have.
And, I appreciate you bringing the technology to us, and saying, hey, this is an option that's available to us, because, I'm curious to see if we can save some money using it.
Absolutely. In this day and age, technology is so important to our industry. We don't want to get behind. We don't want to leave us behind. So. We really do need to try to stay on top of it.
I think a six-year-old system is getting kind of old. But what kind of information do you have about how many people can really pay their bill like that through that system? And is that just like punching your debit card or something and it's paid?
Currently everybody can pay their bill online. Any township resident can go online and pay their bill.
Yeah, but there's a fee, right?
There's a fee, and with this there would still be a fee. It would just take you to official payments, which is where we do our online bills now. People, I think there's between a $2 and $3 fee for you to go online, maybe even $5 to pay your water bill. To some people, if they don't have to drive to Township Hall or if they don't have to order a book of checks, they'll pay the fees. So I've really been trying hard to make it known that you can go online and pay by credit card, because most people, they don't want to mail a check or come here anymore. And we get tons of inquiries about that every day.
How many people actually do it, what percentage?
There's quite a few. I think it's kind of a cumbersome process right now, because I think the cashiers have to run reports and stuff, but that's something we're going to look into in the future also, how we can make paying water bills easier for people.
That'd be good.
Can you let us know on the percentage of people that
Yeah, we could probably figure that out easy enough.
Just, you know, curious, not the media.
Yeah, absolutely.
We also have the option that if the residents want to have us debit their checking account,
right. We'll
do it automatically for them. We set it up.
Sure.
And so we got quite a few of them on that, and there's no fee whatsoever on that,
right. Okay? Yeah.
And there were some banks out there, they're getting fewer between that would do it for free. But we do have quite a few people paying taxes through their own accounts. They just sign a form with us, and we do it automatically for summer tax, winter tax, and there's no fee.
Yeah, we do have quite a bit of people doing automatic payments also.
Right.
Lately, I've heard from a few people that have canceled them because some people, for whatever reason, don't check their mail as often. They don't get their water bill until it's already posted to their account, and it's larger than what they thought, and they wanted to have a chance to
get the money in.
Yeah, they wanted to have a chance to come and talk to us about it or make sure. Most people, the bills are set up so that you get your water bill a week before it actually comes out of your account. So usually it's not a problem, but some people have become upset with that. But just, we've had a huge influx of customers that want different options.
Jeff, how many of our current customers have said anything to DPW about preferring monthly bills over quarterly?
I say we get probably two or three customers a week that want that, including myself. I say it every day. People want monthly bills because it's easier for budgeting. Right now we bill quarterly. You never know what you're going to get whenever that quarter. It's the same with month. You're never going to know what you're going to get month to month. But, you know, a lot of people want your water bill, your sewer bill to come to you just like your Comcast bill or your AT&T bill. They want it monthly. That's something that I've kind of been preaching since I've been here, but haven't had the time to really look into it. With our FlexNet system, it obviously makes it a lot easier for us to get to monthly billing because we don't have to send a meter reader around now. There are other processes that we need to look at, obviously, processing the bills, printing the bills, everything else. We have to look at all that to see what it actually entails, but that is something we are going to be looking at this year. And we'll be bringing that to the board. We wouldn't make that decision, obviously.
What about e-bills? How many people do you think would be interested in that?
People that get email, others that don't, probably would like it too much.
I know, but do you think a lot of people would like that?
I think some might, yeah. There's a lot of people that get electronic bills that don't get paper bills anymore. I don't know really what the percentage would be, being that the biggest customer base that we have here, I mean, the majority of the township is senior citizens. A lot of them probably would not prefer to get electronic bills. Maybe they will, though. I don't know. That would probably also entail switching to another billing procedure and everything else. So there's steps that we need to take just to be more accessible to residents and give them more options. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Are there any more questions?
Anything else?
And I'll be back in a month with more information.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll
be here.
Okay. Dennis, do you have anything
for
management report?
The only thing I'd like to let the board know is Mickey's just a touch based on the Tech Village meeting that we had yesterday with Mr. Potter and Row Engineering, Mickey, Jeff, I, and we had the planner in. And we talked a lot about Tech Village and the concept where we're moving. We did have the principals from the property that participated in that joint public-private partnership provide an update. We're happy to report that Clear Zoning has started work on it. They are well on the way. You guys saw the survey that I sent out. If any of you jumped on it right away, you saw question number 13 had the wrong city information in there that was corrected over the weekend. But those surveys are out. We will get that onto our website. We're going to try to get as many people to respond as possible. It will go out to the chamber as well, and the chamber is going to send it out to all of their business partners to try to get as much feedback as we can. If you haven't had the opportunity yet, take the time to click on the survey and walk through it. It takes, five, 10 minutes or whatever to get through there, but that information will be valuable as we put that market study together. We did look at, Jack Wheely had brought in a copy of a conceptual plan that he had already kind of sketched together out there that showed what the potential could exist out there and what that might look like from a square footage and a number of building standpoint, as well as some proposed or potential nature trails. So, you know, with a conservation easement and that beautiful property out there with some nice water features, some high points, some rolling hills. So we're excited to see it happen. It looks like we're on schedule. Of course, I want it sooner, but we're not going to get it probably before September, before we have that whole conceptual plan to the board to be able to look at. But we should have the market study information back in July. We should have that conceptual report, potentially at the end of August, but I wouldn't count on it. I'd say, that first half of September. And then from there, we still have some zoning things to clear up, but we would be starting that the marketing phase of moving that project forward and trying to attract some developers to Grand Blanc Township. So it could be a really exciting time for us come this fall.
I just want to make the announcement that the open house for the Perry House is this weekend. Drop by. And now it's time to go
into... Motion to go into executive session to discuss deputy clerk compensation.
Well, actually, it's a written attorney opinion that I sent to you, okay. But that's included in it.
Motion to go into executive session to discuss written attorney opinion. Support.
Okay. Roll call.
Mr. Bennett.
Yes.
Ms. Hoffman. Yes. Mrs. Hoffman.
Yes.
Mr. Guzik.
Yes.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes.
Mr. Reardon.
Yes.
Mr. Kent.
Yes.
Passes 5 minutes, people.